Good evening and welcome to tonight's meeting of the executive. Before we get into the formal meeting, I want to say a few words about Councillor Roger Croft, who was the leader of West Berkshire Council. Some of you may know already that unfortunately Roger lost his fight for life quite recently following a road traffic accident in France, which took the life of his wife as well. I had the great privilege of working with Roger over the last 18 months, 2 years. It's fair to say he became leader by accident, but nevertheless, it was a very, very good leader, and we were working together on quite a few ideas, and over the last 18 months became a very strong personal friend. It is absolutely a great loss for the residents of West Berkshire he's no longer with us. So in a mark of respect, I would like to do a 1 minute of silence for him. So if I can ask everybody to stand, please. Thank you very much. Right, let's start off. Do we have any apologies?
Councillor Ashwell
and Councillor Taylor. Okay, and those of you who will notice their deputies are standing in for them. They will be able to fully participate, but any vote that we make as an executive, they are not allowed to vote. They can participate, but not vote. Those of you also, you'll see there's a camera here. If you're here to ask a question, the proceedings are being filmed, but the camera is always faced on the executive here, not on the speaker. You don't need to worry about it being camera shy. Minutes of previous meetings. Pages 7 to 36, is there any comments, corrections, or can I sign them as approved record? All those in favour, please show. Thank you. Declaration of interest.
Can I declare an interest in the council-owned company's business item in the my husband's a director of one of the council-owned companies?
I've got an in. I'm chairman of the Octolus, and therefore I have an interest in the council-owned companies. I will stay in the room, but I won't vote or participate. And for the second item on the merger, I will leave in and feel like
thank you. So, public question time.
Thank you very much. My question is to the Executive Member for Highways and Transport. One of the issues has been raised with me again recently and consistently has been the inconsiderate and sometimes illegal parking around our local schools such as Lobb and Hawkton, with the yellow lines often being ignored. Could you explain how civil parking enforcement will help put a stop to inconsiderate parking around our local schools?
civil park enforcement, or CPE, it'll firstly ensure that vehicles that are parked in contravention of any yellow lines or across dropped curbs, private drives, or any restriction like that will be issued with penalties. The penalties serve as a reminder to drivers of the rules that are in place, and they're a benefit of all, and encourage a change of behaviour. The idea is not to keep breaking the rules and park badly. Secondly, the enforcement officers that are inspecting the areas around schools and other areas are also a very public face of the council, and they can help to further encourage a behaviour change through discussions with the public about the safety impacts and the regulations following the parking rules.
Do you have a supplementary? Yes, I do. Thank you very much for that answer. I noticed yesterday that the consultation went live. Regarding these specific schools that in the local schools in the area, would you consider proposals to extend specific regulation for waiting times, etc., just to fill in some obvious gaps that have become obvious to me?
Well, firstly, CPE is in the process of being set up and applied for at the moment, and we hope it will be installed in the last quarter of the year, and that will be with all the regulations that currently apply. So all the yellow lines, the restrictions, so on, are currently there. It's not really practical to put new ones in before the existing ones go live. But once CPE is there, that will already provide improved coverage. And then if there are areas, obviously with schools and the like, where they want variations, either longer yellow lines or different restrictions, they can discuss those with us, and they could end up with a regular traffic regulation order that will meet their needs.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Grayson. Is Mr. Michael Jones here? Would you like to step forward and ask your question, please? Thank you.
Regarding the redevelopment of Borough Road South, given that the council documentation shows a major concern for residents and for the lack of certainty of this project, why is there no firm commitment for the ability to continue the project after phase one and the monies required for completion should surely be allocated before commencement?
Thank you, Mr. Jones, for your question. The executive report commits the council to delivering and funding phase one and to undertaking feasibility work to develop the proposals for later phases. The feasibility work will identify the scale of the redevelopment and is therefore its likely cost. Until this work is completed, the council cannot allocate funding for later phases. The report is clear that a firm proposal will come back to the executive by March 2018.
Do you have supplementary?
Yes, it's just that particularly the owner occupiers there are in a bit of a cleft stick because they have got no opportunity to sell and move within the area, certainly. And why are we not looking at the whole project as one rather than separate phases?
Because of the way the funding works for a redevelopment of this size, we have to look at it in phases. We can't sort of come up with the money, that much money, to do the whole thing in one go. But we are committed to actually the redevelopment of Gorse Ride. We have to work through a framework so we can allocate the money as things come up, but we are committed to doing that.
For sure, you can allocate the money as a whole.
Excuse me. Sorry, you had your one supplementary. What I suggest is that the two of you get together or have a conversation outside the meeting.
Thank you, that'd be useful.
Yep. Right. If you can, after the meeting or before you go, leave your contact details.
Or we can speak once this is finished.
Okay, fine.
Right. Thank you. Peter Must, would you like to come forward and ask your question, please? Thank you.
For the executive member for Resident Services. Since the proposed relocation of Wokingham Library, probably the major public community facility in the town, is posited on an improved service for residents, is it not vital to consult local people to discover their views on the proposal, a measure that could be achieved, for example, by amending the recommendation to read, first, that a public consultation be held about proposal to relocate Wokingham Library to a new building on the Carnival Phase 2 site, and two, that any proposal to relocate the library be then submitted to the executive by the executive member for resident services with a summary of the responses to the consultation together with a full impact assessment and detailed business case.
Thank you, Mr. Moss. Firstly, I'd like to preface this answer by saying I wouldn't support this proposal if I didn't think it provided a real opportunity to further enhance our library offer. And I hope by the end of the process that we're going to go through, that residents will be as excited as I am about the opportunities that the relocation could provide. The council conducted its extensive consultation in 2016 about the proposed library offer for the borough. I've got a copy of it here if you'd like to see it, including the guiding principles of the service and the way it would be delivered. These views were the cornerstone of the new library offer that was adopted by the council in 2016. The proposed relocation of Wokingham Library to the Carnival Phase 2 site will not result in a reduction of the service or fundamental change to the core services that are available to residents. From the consultation held last year, it was clear that residents wanted the library to retain books as a primary stock type, to offer facilities that support learning and achievement, and to continue to meet residents' expectations for utilising and embracing new technology. The consultation also showed there was overwhelming support for our libraries to be able to adapt to changing needs of our residents and to offer access to other council services and to broaden the range of activities and events that people can enjoy. Furthermore, there was strong support for co-locating library services alongside other services, including sports facilities. Over 1,000 people responded to the consultation on the library offer, and only 25% of them did not agree with co-location. Our residents have already provided the council with a strong statement about their preferences and aspirations. The proposed new site for Wokingham Library will offer more usable space, greater flexibility, being located on one floor, which means that you only have one entrance, and it also has vastly improved car parking facilities. Being adjacent to a destination leisure facilities, we think that will also attract people of all ages. Being able to offer all these improvements on a site that's less than 300 metres away and clearly visible from the entrance of the current library is an extremely positive opportunity for the council. However, still want to hear people's views as the proposals take shape. The actual library itself won't start building until 2021, so there's plenty of opportunity for people to give us their views now and through the period up to 2021. I would be really, really interested to hear particularly what users of the library think about this, and also particularly about what residents of Wokingham think. And hopefully we'll be able to start communicating through the process following the agreement of this in principle to actually help explain to people what the facilities will be and what the benefits are, and also listen to their feedback about what they like.
Do you have something?
Well, might I confess to some confusion as to whether that's consultation or just telling people what you're proposing to do. You say you hope everybody will be enthusiastic about it, but why don't you ask them to find out before you start rather than at the end of it?
The reason we're going for consultation now is because it's required as part of the planning process. That doesn't mean we actually have to do the change. So what we're doing is putting the approval in principle to make the change in now as part of the kick-off to the planning process, which is part of the consolidation work around Wokingham Town Centre. However, I'm very interested to hear what people think. We will be actually asking them properly. It's not a formal consultation, because formal consultations are not required if the services are actually being improved rather than reduced. But, nevertheless, in all intents and purposes, it will be a consultation to listen to what people want and to try and change the plans according to what people think.
Thank you. And if I can add, I will not lend, as leader, I will not lend any support to any proposal that reduces the quality of our current library service. So I'm quite happy to get that on the record.
Thank you.
Thank you. Keith Morgan, would you like to come up and ask your question, please? Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks very much. My question is similarly to the Executive Member for Resident Services. It's on agenda item 134, the proposed relocation of Wokingham Library. It runs as follows. The first time I was aware of this proposal was when the executive agenda was published last Wednesday. Although the Town Council and local members were made aware of this on the 22nd of February, more than a month ago. Have you had any response from the Town Council or local members to give support to the view expressed at the start of the report that this proposal will offer better access and parking to existing users of the library and will allow them to combine visits with other activities?
Thank you, and it was good to speak to you earlier in the week from the car.
It's a pleasure.
The Town Council and local members were advised on the 22nd of February, as you say. Obviously, quite a lot of people are dual-hatted members, and we've had support from all of them. But in addition, we got a response from Lynn Forbes, who's the independent, one of the independent members for Wokingham Town Council, who said she was very much in support of the proposal and thought it was a good idea.
I'm sure you have accepted something, Andrew.
Well, yes, well, obviously the principle, that you've accepted the principle of consultation. It's unfortunate that you haven't extended any further than that, giving people a wider opportunity. You referred already to the outcome of the library offer, which this is an extract from the thing we've been sent together with a bill for £2,000. This is from the, you will know where it's from. This is published around the same time. What I don't understand is why no opportunity was taken at this stage to notify people that a proposal was to relocate Wokingham Library from where it is. And I would urge you that you make the statement that this will offer improved access. And so without talking to the users, I'm not a great fan of multi-story car parks. For example, I'm prejudiced. I drive badly. I don't want to park my car there. I'd much rather that surface of a car park. So it's no good for me. You know, my mobility scooter, which will be coming soon, I think, does it offer me better access? These are just examples where I feel that you give no thought whatsoever.
Do you want to answer, or is it more? As I said, I had a conversation with you earlier, and I'm very interested in your feedback. The actual car park for the swimming pool will be single floor, so you needn't worry about your parking abilities or your mobility scheme. But as I say, there will be plenty of opportunity, both through the planning process and also prior to that, for people to provide views and ideas about the design and actually try and get some input to what the future facility looks like. If we get this right, it could be really an asset for the whole borough. And also working with some.
Formal consultation starts now then.
And if I can just add with your comment on mobility scooter, I'm sure you would agree a facility that's on one floor must be better than a facility that's on multiple floors. Bear in mind, if you've got a mobility scooter, you're implying you've got mobility issues. Thank you.
It's unusual, isn't it? Yeah, we're going to vote on that.
Now we move, that's the last of the public questions. We'll now move into the member questions. Prue, would you like to ask your question, please?
Good evening, everybody. On the same thing. Hello, Pauline. Why the lack of consultation with residents on the proposed relocation of Woking Library?
I think I've largely answered that. There was quite a lot of consultation as part of the library. Sorry, this thing's got a dodgy widget. But I'm losing my voice as well, which probably doesn't help. We did a lot of consultations as part of the library offer. It was quite clear from that people were keen on co-location of facilities, which allows us and will allow us to reduce the cost of running facilities, and as we've done previously, just recently, increase the opening hours and increase the provision of libraries. We're one of the few councils in the country that's actually managed to improve our library service rather than reducing it or shutting libraries. You know I'm very passionate about libraries. I believe this is a great opportunity, and I look forward to emails from anybody and everybody, plus proper opportunity to comment on the proposals as they become published in the next few weeks. We expect to have something on the council website in about a month's time, which will give more detail.
I'm sure you have something.
Yeah, there's about 15 supplementaries, but I'll confine myself to one, otherwise I'll get the other.
I tell you what, you can have two.
The previous consultation asked general questions, didn't refer to any specific library moving. So perhaps you'd like to comment on that. But I think I would like to pick up a comment you made earlier on this evening, which is about this is not a formal consultation, but informal consultation, apart from the planning bit of it, which is a formal planning consultation, which is an entirely different thing. So how will library users know that there's a consultation and how to respond to it? And will they actually be given an opportunity to influence the outcome?
I can guarantee you that they will have the opportunity to influence the outcome. We will be putting posters up around the area and also within the libraries, and we'll be providing the opportunity for people to feedback. We'll make sure it gets plenty of publicity, as I'm sure our friends at the press will, and I'm very much looking forward to people getting involved in the project and actually telling us a bit about what they want as well.
Thank you. Thank you. Rochelle, I'm assuming standing here for a minute. Can I just remind you that
Why was this proposal kept secret from the Wokingham Borough members until now?
Thank you, Rochelle. I'd like to reassure members and the public there's been no secrecy around the proposals to relocate Wokingham Library. The proposal to consider moving the library is a further step towards improving local services, and in line with the feedback we've received in support of exploring ways to provide greater flexibility within our library services while still retaining the core elements that residents clearly value. This proposal is another step in the realisation of the library offer and the Carnival Phase 2 development, as the council now begins to look at more detail at the land uses that could be, make up this exciting development and the proposed layout and design of the facilities. The principle of moving the library has become public at the expected time, and it's now correct to ask residents and users what they think. Everyone will have the opportunity to give their say on the detailed proposals for Carnival Phase 2 scheme during next month's public engagement. The decision taken tonight is one on a matter of principle, and should executive agree this evening, the principal will be subject to further design and feasibility work. The library will not be moving until 2021 if the design and feasibility work is successful, and there is plenty of opportunity for members and the public to contribute to the detailed design processes between now and then.
Thank you. Brian, would you like to step up and ask your question, please?
Thank you, Keith. My question's for you, Pauline. How much have you just spent on updating the existing Wokingham Library?
Is it?
That's it.
Okay.
Nice and easy.
We've just put in 4 self-service kiosks and new RFID scanners for the staff, a new counter, and associated installation and decorating works. In total, these improvements are budgeted to cost £47,000. In making this investment, it should be understood that it's expected that self-service kiosks and the RFID scanners will still be in use in 2021, and therefore will be redeployed within the new library site in the Carnival Phase 2 development. The new library counter is a modular design and can also be reused in another location. As is stated, the adoption of the library offer is not going to happen. The adoption of the library offer saved us around about £130,000 a year and allowed us to increase our opening times by 17 and a half hours a week. I think that's very important because I believe very strongly that libraries are used by large numbers of the population, and I think they're a very valuable asset, particularly to school children and also the elderly. So I'm very proud of the fact that we've managed to increase the use of libraries and invest in new technology and move them forward, and I'm looking forward to this proposal helping that further.
I'm sure you have a supplementary.
I do, thank you. Do you think that it would have been better to wait until 2021 to spend the £47,000? Do you consider that this money has been well spent now that you're relocating the library? Or do you think that it's a waste of the council's scarce resources?
No, I think it is the right time to do it. The only resources that we've spent on the Wokingham Library that will be wasted, in inverted commas, is a bit of paint. And that will probably be requiring repainting in 2021 anyway. So I think what we've done is quite correct, quite have to stand behind it, and I'm really looking forward to moving this project forward.
Michelle, I'd like to ask you a question in your own mind this time.
Will the Elevate Hub be included in the proposal for the new library site?
The honest answer, Rochelle, is I don't know yet. The Elevate Hub is funded by time-limited and government and EU subsidy funds. Work is ongoing to look at longer-term options for this service in that context and the future funding availability in the 21st Century Council programme. The specific details of which services will be available or located with the proposed library in the Carnival Phase 2 development is still to be determined. It's 4 years between the decision and the actual relocation. I think the Elevate Hub provides very important services for NEETs and to increase the employment in the area, but at the moment we just don't know. It depends on funding.
I'm sure you have a supplementary.
Will the money made from selling the Carnival Pool car park and the library site itself be used for youth services or to prop up the Carnival Pool development?
I can't answer the question on the Carnival Pool development other than I think it's self-funding and therefore doesn't require sale of other facilities. Anybody disagrees with me could possibly correct me. But the long-term options for the site really haven't been looked at yet. There's no guarantee we will sell it at all. Don't know what we're going to do with the current site. Once we decide what we're going to do with the current site and have a view about what we're going to do with the current site, we'll of course consult on that separately.
I presume you meant the car park on the current library site, not the car park. I think you meant the car park on the current library site, not the car park on the Carmel Pool site.
No, I don't think there's any intent to sell that.
I would assume the car park on the library site will continue to generate income from the council for a car parking charge until and unless it is decided to be redeveloped. So it will continue to generate funds which we will spend wisely as we always do.
Thank you, Anthony.
I
know
the
course
by the
council.
You know the record.
Thank you. That's the end of the member question time. This is the members and the general public. You do not need to stay until the end. But if you do, enjoy the next few sessions. So we're now moving into the matters of consideration, number 130, which is Council Owned Company's Business. This is the standard update report. There's only a couple of things I'm going to just draw your attention to. From an optimist perspective, page 39, on care governance, you'll see that Suffolk Lodge now has been removed from the care governance framework. Congratulations to all the relevant people involved in Optilis to achieve that particular action, which was taken a long time and a lot of effort, but well done to them. Then on WHL, if you spin to page 42, there are two really big projects, Phoenix Avenue and the Foster's Extra Care Home. Foster's, you'll see, is on time and to budget. Phoenix Avenue is well underway, despite some issues around poor weather, etc. going on. So if there's any questions, I do have the current chairman of Optilis and the commissioner of WHL. Yeah. There's no...
Sorry.
That's all right. Just don't die on this, please. We need the quorum. So, the recommendations, if there's no questions, the recommendations on page 37, 1 to 4. All those in favour, please show. That's unanimous. So, now we move on to 131.
If you would excuse me.
Page 45. I'd just like to make a statement. The reason why Councillor Pollock has left is because he currently sits on the Optilis board as chairman and therefore has a potential prejudicial interest in here. Just to clarify, Councillor Anthony Pollock and Councillor Simon Weeks, who are the two Council and non-executive directors on the Optus board will be resigning from that board in order to, as an alternative, to sit on the shareholder governance board of Optus Holdings alongside David Lee and three elected members from Windsor and Maidenhead. And with that, I'll hand over to Councillor Lee Sumner, who will introduce the panel.
Here, that's pretty much what I was going to say, so you covered it quite nicely. The only additional amendment is on the additional pages in front of you, amendment 3, support the formal establishment of the new company, Optus Limited, owned jointly by Woking Borough Council, Royal Borough of Windsor and Maidenhead, which will go live and start to trade on the 3rd of April 2017. So happy to take any questions if there are any, if not, just vote.
Are there any questions? This is quite exciting. It's part of the long-standing vision of Councillor David Lee when we set up the companies with a view that these companies would take on work beyond just working in Borough. And this is a prime example of this. So
If there's no questions, then the page 45, you've got recommendations 1 and 2 plus an additional 1 and 3 on your single paper. So all those in favour, please show. Thank you. Can somebody go ahead? So now we get on the interesting bit, discretionary land acquisition policy. Welcome, you want to introduce us, please?
The council is currently in the process of delivering a number of new road schemes across the borough. These obviously need land on which to be located. In order to deliver these projects, the council will buy land and properties that are needed, either by negotiation, by compulsory purchase, or following the acceptance of a blight notice. There may be occasions sometimes when a property will be affected by a road scheme, even though no part of it is part of the scheme, because of its proximity or some other instances. There may be, for instance, people cannot move because it becomes less attractive to sell or their property if somebody's building a road down the road. The land is not part of the development, but it may be affected by it. And what this document does is it sets out the terms and conditions under which one can submit a claim to the local authority with instances which are considered to be blight. And then the council is under no obligation to purchase property at all, but it has the ability to negotiate with them and evaluate the evidence and decide whether it would be of use. In this way, it means that people who are not part of the land that's being built on, but may be seriously affected by it, have a fair and consistent system for dealing with the problem.
Thank you, Malcolm.
Thank you. Sorry.
Any questions? No? No? So, seems to be fairly straightforward. Just a single recommendation on page 49. All those in favour, please show. That's unanimous. Oh, another riveting one. On page 61, agenda item 123, policy for revisions, additions to the list of buildings of traditional local character. We do have some amended recommendations. So, Chris, would you like to talk us through it, please?
Thank you, Chairman. We have around about 46 buildings which we deem to be buildings of traditional local character. They are buildings which are really one step down from the scheme of Grade 1 and Grade 2 listed buildings. The problem for the council is that we don't have a means of updating that list, we can't add to it and we can't delete. So that is really what this paper is about. We've also taken advantage of this to include an appeal system which allows people who are dissatisfied with any additions or deletions to appeal to the planning committee. And as the Chairman said, there is an amendment which I think members have got, which is purely clerical, which is to move paragraph 6 from the appendix 3, which is the procedure for appeals, creating paragraph 12 in appendix 2, which is where it should have been in the first place.
Right. So do we have any questions or comments for Chris? We'll go straight to the vote. The recommendations are there on page 61. All those in favour, please show. Unanimous. Just as we thought we got away from the library, see, it's the libraries again. Page 69, agenda item 134. Pauline.
Thank you very much, Keith. With the recommendations that I've got here, I think I'd like to add another recommendation, which adds that publicity to allow people who are interested in the proposal and would like to feedback on either the design or indeed the proposals themselves should start as soon as practical after this paper is approved, and that we would be very interested in feedback from all the members of the public who would like to provide us information on what they believe is the right answer for Wokingham Library. Are you happy to accept that as an amendment?
Yes. I think in light of the questions and comments, I think that's an invaluable addition. So, any questions, Anthony?
really just a comment, I think. The opportunity, it seems to me, to do this co-location is an opportunity for the public to have better parking facilities, and for them, I think the quality of the car park and it being on a level that's much better than the car park at the current library site, which is on a significant slope. So I do think this is a proposal that's got significant merit. I think that the opportunity for people to take advantage of the leisure offer, there are possibilities of looking at some business-related workspace as well, so people would also have business meetings. There's also be close to the new town centre and to the new shops and shopping facilities there. So I would see this as being a really exciting new development in the town centre and an appropriate site for this to happen. And I think it's a warm welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman. Yes, so going on from Anthony's contribution there, which I support. Co-locating with the planned renewal of the Carnival Pool and the additional facilities we envisaged there to put in one place a car park, reception, cafe, a number of other things possibly, it's just a win-win-win. It will have design impacts and obviously that leads to, internally we have ensured that there will be joined up thinking between the town centre regenerative elements of it, the library elements, and the leisure centre ones. So the whole thing will be pulled together, and I think it's a very exciting idea.
Richard? Thank you, Chair. Somebody that actually wears AFOs on both legs and is disabled, the notion of was it a one-floor library really is exciting. Accessibility to the present library is okay, but it's not fit for purpose. So I welcome that. On the other note, I hope that the consultation does actually embrace schools, and that we talk to all our schools about the opportunities that a proposal could bring. And not just in terms of a lending library, but also what other was it opportunities the actual space offers children.
Can I just come back on that? One of the things the library team particularly wanted me to mention was that they want to improve and continue to support the access for school children. A lot of the reason why our libraries are so successful is things like Read with Dad for the smaller kids, a lot of music and rhyme time facilities for small children to get them involved in reading, the ability to get badges and tokens and that sort of stuff as you go around as part of the summer reading challenge. The library staff work very, very hard to try and increase the library footfall and to give people who might otherwise not have access to books a real passion for reading, which lasts for the rest of their life. I think it's really, really important. And I can assure you that we won't be forgetting that. It's a really good opportunity. The current library has a lot of wasted space with the stairs and the two levels. The access isn't brilliant with the hill going up into the car park. This really gives us the opportunity to do something special. And it's not often you get a chance to do something on a new site for a library. Although we've done one already, and you never know, we might manage to get another one before I retire.
Thank you. If there's no other comment, I just have a comment. As far as I'm aware, no other local authority in Berkshire has managed to open a new library, has increased the footfall and put in such new technology. And we're quite used to co-location because there is an amazing success over in the Finch Hampstead Baptist Church, where the library was moved in to co-locate with leisure facilities there, not a swimming pool, but all the leisure facilities there, and it's been a real rip-roaring success. So we've got a track record, we know it works. So only remains then to go to the recommendations, page 79, all those in favour, please show. That's unanimous. Compulsory purchase order in principle resolution.
Yes, thank you, Chair. This concerns the carnival redevelopment. Again, it's part of the Wokingham town regeneration. There is some land here which is not in the council's ownership, but which the council requires to complete the project on time. Negotiations have been going on for some time with the landowner, but they have not yet been successful. So, council believes that it would be prudent to indicate its intentions. And so this paper is an in-principle resolution for a compulsory purchase order. It's not a compulsory purchase order in itself. I think it clearly lays out that the council is determined to complete this project on time and successful.
Thank you.
I think we used this principle elsewhere in the town centre when we needed to negotiate with another of the companies in the town centre to get their attention to redevelop Peach Place development. So I think this is a tried and tested approach. I hope that we will be able to engage with the current landowner and come to a suitable resolution. But if we can't, obviously the site is required and we will have to use these powers because it's important, an important project, and these powers exist to help us to complete and be a leader in our community.
I just note that in the paperwork it says that you've been negotiating with the landowner for 3 years. So we have been bending over backwards to find alternative sites, so we do need this in our back pocket just to get over that finishing line. So recommendations are on page 75/76, there's three of them. All those in favour, please show. That's unanimous. Public sector equality duty, Pauline.
I'd just like to propose the adoption of this just like to propose the adoption of this paper on public sector equality. It should one of our duties under the Equality Act of 2010, and it gives a bit of an update both on the mix of population in Wokingham and also the ways the Borough Council acts to try and ensure that everybody is treated fairly and equally, and that everybody has the opportunity that they deserve.
Any questions? Can I go straight to the vote? Angus?
Not so much a question, but just something I've noted here with interest, that on page 92, almost down to the end of the bullet points, we talk about the population that are in employment, and we're very modern because we say between the age of 16 and 74.
Like a broad range.
Yes, I still fit into that. Any other questions or comments? Okay, the recommendations are page 89, four of them. All those in favour, please show. That's unanimous. Now we move on to page 117. Strategic review of the voluntary sector services. Probably about a year ago, I moved the voluntary sector responsibility from the then executive member to myself. I've had a long-standing personal interest within the voluntary sector because they provide so much valuable work to our residents, and they deserve a much better focus. And I believe, as leader, I can give them that focus. What this is, the recommendations here, is that we are doing a strategic review. We're reviewing with certain objectives in mind. The primary one would be, are the organisations, the voluntary organisations, actually providing the benefits that we want to our residents? So that's the first thing, and obviously on the basis of that we need to identify what that benefit should be. So this review will be talking to each individual voluntary sector to map out what we're looking for as a council, what our residents are looking for, and what their capacity is to deliver it. It is also moving away from the concept of effectively an annual grant, where we effectively just write out a cheque, it goes into someone's bank account, and then it's used for whatever that voluntary sector. So it's more focused to do that. There's quid pro quo. We will also be giving them, instead of annual grants, we will be looking for them to give them grants of typically 3 years, which will allow them to be able to plan their whole operation. That's one of the most the biggest difficulties of voluntary sector organisations is planning. If you don't know, you know, from 1 year to the next what your grant is going to be, or if you're going to have a grant, it makes it very, very difficult to do that planning. So it's moving the whole paradigm, pardon the word, but effectively it's moving that paradigm away from the old traditional, here's a cheque with money, into let's work together under partnership to give the residents the outcome that they're looking for, and we're giving you a degree of security. if there's any questions? No? Angus?
It's just a point, Chairman, that I'm totally behind this. I think it is very necessary for us to ensure there's a great partnership with the voluntary sector, especially where areas that we've got financial restraints. There are also areas which we, I think, need to link with this, where already for us there are volunteer organisations. There's a whole group of people who help with looking after the country farms, for instance. And we just launched an initiative for volunteers in sport. So I think, as well as going to the established voluntary organisation outside, we also need to link it into those parts which are already within the councils.
You make a very good point, and we'll take that into consideration. The other thing I will say, the budget for our voluntary community sector services area will be maintained at least for the foreseeable future. Who knows what the government's going to do in 2 years' time in terms of budget, but the intention certainly for the next year, potentially the next year after that, will be to maintain the budget. Hopefully we'll get a much, much better outcome at the end of the day for all of us, for this voluntary organisation, for the residents and us as a council. So the recommendations there are on 117. All those in favour, please show. Thank you. We move to the last one, on 123, agenda item 138. And there is some additional recommendations that I brought to your attention. I'll hand over to Julian.
Okay, thank you, Chairman. The regeneration of Gorse Ride South, this is the first phase, the first a number of phases, we believe. It is an exciting and I think worthwhile exercise to undertake. It's certainly something that I know our residents have been talking to us about for a little while. We spend a great deal of money on our housing. It's about time that we sort of spent some on it in Finch-Hampstead. Additional item 8, the council's long-term intent to regenerate Gorse Ride South estate subject to funding. I'm happy to take any questions.
Anthony?
Yes, I just really wanted to warmly support the proposal. This has been an area which I've been keen that we did do some work on redevelopment for a number of years now. It's an estate that perhaps is a little bit on the card end and has various issues. I would also expect us that we will find a way to complete the project, so I would seek to give some reassurance to the questioner that the fact that we are only talking about phase one now, this is a key bit. That is, we are keen to get on with this, but I would expect us to be finding ways to finance this over maybe a longer period, but given the nature of the estate and the importance of this area to council tenants, I think it's an exciting opportunity and well worthwhile. And so, we'll be supporting.
Thank you. Thank you. Any other questions? I believe this is going to be a multi-year, 4 or 5 years or something?
It will be purely for the size of it and the nature. It's impossible to do it unless we have an infrastructure of very, very big pockets, which the government ensured that we don't have. So yes, it will be on a number of phases. This is the first phase. We hope that once the first phase is completed, we'll head towards the second phase before that one sort of finishes, and then we actually sort of take residents with us because we want to improve what's already there now.
Thank you. And just before we go to the vote, I've been asked by Councillor Simon Weeks, which is the member for Finch Hampstead South, to read out a statement on his behalf, and I will use my discretion to do that. Unfortunately, he couldn't be here. He's had to go to an AGM, which he needed to be at. But this is what Councillor Simon Weeks says, and it's interesting for those of us who haven't been on council for as long as he has. As ward councillor for Finch Hampstead South, I fully support item 138, the proposed redevelopment of the Gorthright South Estate. As a child, I watched the estate being built, and at that time, everyone marvelled at the use of the new building construction techniques and utilisation of unconventional materials which enabled such a rapid provision of urgently needed affordable housing. Unfortunately, for many years, it's been very apparent that these homes have not stood the test of time and were increasingly expensive to maintain, poorly insulated and generally not of the suitable modern standards that the residents rightly deserved. On a positive note, there is a good community spirit at Gorthright, and many residents have lived there for a long period, so they have developed strong local links with their neighbours and family in the locality. The proposed phased regeneration will give many residents the opportunity to remain on Gorthright, but with brand new homes, which provide a great improvement in their living conditions and the running costs of the houses for them as tenants. Undoubtedly, the scheme will bring short-term disruption, but I am confident that following on from the successful rebuild at Phoenix Avenue, Wokingham Borough Council has the experience and determination to minimise the impact on the affected residents' lives. Simply ignoring the deteriorating condition of the homes to avoid any disruption to residents' lives is just not a practical solution to a growing problem. Action is overdue. The Council's vision to provide greatly improved homes was explained in a public meeting last week, which was attended by about 150 residents of Gorthright South. So in summary, I would like for the second time in my life to see new homes being built at Gorthright South. The result should be a community that all will be proud of. Thanks. And those of you who haven't been over there, Gorthright is right next door to the Finch Hampstead Baptist Church complex with all the great facilities in there. So it's a great combination of affordable housing and all those facilities. So the recommendations, you've got them on 1, 2, 3 plus the extra one of 8. Council long term intent to regenerate the Gorthright South Estate subject to funding. All those in favour, please show. That is unanimous, and I believe that is the end of the meeting. Thank you all for your participation and forbearance for lasting all this long.